What are your current terms with WCW? You have been around the wrestling world for quite a couple of months now, and you made one spot appearance. But
right, you remember that. Very good.
Yeah, yeah. Thunder, the Battle Royale.
Absolutely. With WCW, I have no contract. I didn't even have a contract when I did that one appearance. They called me up to come back and do a one-shot deal, and I said, okay, I'll do that. And right now I'm a free agent, and I like it like that. You know what I mean? Just chilling on the sidelines, watching everything develop. Really don't want to commit to WCW because they're really hurting right now. You know what I mean? And everybody wants to go where the action is, and WWF is the place to be. So I'm just chilling on the sidelines. I'm going to plug myself back in, but Macho Man can't plug himself back in unless there's extreme impact.
Uh-huh.
All right? You know what I mean? Extreme impact, and that's what I have to have.
How did it work out that you ended up wrestling Dennis Rodman in one of the craziest
angles
in
wrestling? They figured put one crazy guy against another crazy guy. They figured he was like a mental problem, so they called the first person that spent more time in a mental institution than any other wrestler, and that would be me. Because I rocked that mental institution, man. I was a leader among the nuts. I was the head cashew.
What was it like wrestling a guy like Rodman who like really had no experience wrestling-wise? You'd have to
show him and that was at Sturgis with in his element with all the motorcycles. You know, and he was nervous because of the fact that it was out of his element, and I took full advantage of that, let me tell you, because that was my backyard at the same time. You know, I used it all against him, but he's a tremendous athlete. I got nothing bad to say about him because he's doing his own thing. You know, the fact that our personalities aren't the same is cool, because if we were all the same, we'd live in the same house, you know, so I'm comfortable with that. Right. And when we went out there, when it was showtime, we rocked it.
Fans gonna get a little stinky around here.
Was everything that you did planned? Because at one point the match went to the back and you were throwing each other into like portable latrines.
Exactly, right. No, that was not planned at all. I decided to give them a lesson in wrestling 101, which is not in the book. But it's a book that I would write if I had time.
Any thoughts about an autobiography on that? Everybody seems to be writing them.
I know, everybody's writing autobiographies, but I don't know. I'm not motivated to do that right now. I want to express myself because there's a lot of things that I'd like to share with people, you know, at a time in the future, but it's not now, because it seems like when people do that, they're reflecting back and they've already, you know, like reached the top. And I feel like I'm not over the hill yet because I haven't reached the top.
One of the things that really stands out from your career is that even when you got into your 40s, you were really considered a wrestler who could still go.
Right.
You were slowed down by a leg injury 2 years ago that really like hit you hard. You were out for like 6 months. Can you tell us a little bit about how that happened?
Yeah. Boy, you've done your homework, man. This guy's on it. You know, I like it, man. That's great when you get interviewed by somebody that knows the deal.
Hey, we're the wrestling guys.
Right, I'm liking it, man. I'm telling you. I never really had it. I thought it was bulletproof before, you know what I mean? All injuries, man, I would just like tape myself up and get right back in there. I had that like old time football tough wrestler mentality, you know, just get up and go type of thing, you know. So when I blew out my knee, it was like, you know, like a blowout when you're at a tire and expressway, man. When I'm going 150 miles an hour down the expressway and all of a sudden I got a blowout, it's like, what's this, man? I was making great time, you know. So that kind of slowed me down, but it also made me smarter. That made me more hungry, you know what I mean? So, you know, anything that happens to you, you just become tougher. You become forged in steel, harder to conflict, more glorious to triumph. So it was really a cool thing that happened because I got the chance to sit back and just figure out what I wanted to do. But I'm stronger than ever right now. I got a chance to, you know, like get back in the gym and not travel as much, you know what I mean? Bouncing around the country, you know, with this oblivious, you know, state of mind, you know what I mean? Where you're just chasing your tail as opposed to just, you know, sitting on the beach, lifting weights and getting ready and to rock and roll, but do it with impact style, you know.
After wrestling like nonstop for like decades, the time off and the injury itself, how hard was it to fight back when you're getting back into the ring?
Pretty hard, you know, except for the fact that I got this little switch inside my brain. When you trip that light, fantastic, and it's showtime, and you hear that roar from the crowd, you know what I mean? And you get those chill bumps all the way up, nose to toes, and then it's not a problem at all, you know. In fact, it's pretty easy for me to get up for something like that, you know, because it's just either inside you or it's not. And I say that when it stops getting to be fun for somebody, they need to get out. And for me, you know what I mean, everybody says, you know, like, I got some like my mom and my dad or whatever, you know, people close to me, they say, why go in there and do it, you know what I mean, because it's still fun for me. You know what I mean? I'm going to keep my fingers in the middle.
One of the most tragic things in wrestling history happened when Owen Hart died on pay-per-view. Do you think there's some who feel that that might have been an omen about wrestling getting too crazy, about the risks getting too big? Do you think, what do you think about that? Do you think that's true to an extent, that we're getting way too away from wrestling and more into these high stunts from 10 feet in the air, 12 feet? Do you think it's going too far?
Owen Hart was a great friend of mine. It wasn't like, you know, I just knew Owen a little bit. I rode up and down the road with him to a lot of the towns. He's a great guy, wife, two kids, you know, building a house, you know, the whole deal. You know what I mean? The white picket fence, the whole thing. You know, and so he was a heck of a human being. And it was the unbelievable tragedy that they, you know, that a nice guy like that, it would happen to him, you know. But that's just whatever it is. I mean, we'll find out when, you know, life's over or whatever, reflecting back on what happens, why it happens. But and you just can't stop things from getting crazy, whether it's in wrestling or anything else, you know. So even though, you know, he was like a best friend, you just can't stop things like that from happening, because it's the entertainment value of the fans. It's the nature of the beast. You know, that's what happens.
Trying to get bigger.
Yeah, and you just can't stop it. And it's a terrible thing, but that's going to be the nature of the beast. And if somebody doesn't do it, they'll find somebody that will.
What was the circumstances surrounding your jump to WCW in 94? There was a lot of talk that the WWF wanted you to do more commentary.
Right.
You wanted to keep in high gear.
That's all it was. That's all it was, is that they wanted me to do the commentary thing, you know, which I will want to do sometime, you know, because mm-hmm. I got a pretty good slanted viewpoint on things, you know.
Yeah.
And I feel that I would like to express it at some time. You know, it's not even now, but mm-hmm. I just wasn't ready, mm-hmm. you know, to take off my boots at that point. I'm glad I didn't, you know what I mean? It was just like, it wasn't that... It wasn't anything but an attitude or a direction which the WWF was going. And they proved to be 100% correct in where they were going, because they had a vision about where they were going. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it didn't work for me mm-hmm. at that time. And I'm glad that I made the move that I did, looking back, because I just wasn't ready to do that. You know, I got to do things because I want to, not because I have to.
Yeah. Was there friction between you and the WWF and Vince McMahon? Not only from that, but then he started up the skits with, you know, Billionaire Ted's skits,
right.
And the Huckster and the Nacho Man. Did that cause friction?
Not at all. Not for me. You know, because when they were doing that, if they wouldn't have put me in the skits, I would have called up Vince McMahon and said, "Hey, brother, be my bro, man. Make fun of me, you know." Because when he made fun of me, it made me important, you know.
There's no such thing as bad publicity.
There's no such thing as bad publicity. That's what you got to do. You know, I just said when it's live TV, nothing can go wrong. You got to shoot from the hip and let it rock, mm-hmm. you know. So when he was doing all those things about me, I was proud.
Yeah.
I want to write him a letter and say, "Vince, thanks. Thanks for thinking about me." Even in a bad sense, I love it.
Mm-hmm. Now, you've had a lot of really high-profile matches. You fought the Warrior at WrestleMania 7. A lot of people believe that was Warrior's best match ever. Flair at WrestleMania 8, you had Hogan. What would you consider to be your best match? You've also had Flair, Rick Steamboat, these are remembered. What do you consider to be your best?
Boy, that's a real, real, real tough question. I think as far as the fans letting me know, feedback from the fans, which is really the most important thing. Yeah. They always point to WrestleMania 3 with Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. And in front of 93,000 plus fans, it's hard to argue with something like that, because it was really a moment in time as far as going down that aisle and feeling that rush from all that energy inside that arena, the Silver Dome, because it was a world indoor record. And it was just like something that you can't even explain. It was a wild time right then, as far as what led up to WrestleMania, and then having that match. It was with somebody as athletic at the time as Ricky the Dragon Steamboat was. You know, we had a pretty quick match right there. I've had some great matches against Andre the Giant, which I'm still recovering from. Right? You know? But that's a phone. That's Vince McMahon calling. Put him on line 3.
There we go.
Not only
do we have the autobiography announcement, now we got the announcement that you're going back to the
WWF.
That's
right. There you
right
go. Vince doesn't even know about it. Right.
A couple of questions left. One I wanted to ask, it's sort of a two-parter. How did you feel doing the marriage at SummerSlam 91? Since there was like a lot of real life, yet, you know, you and Elizabeth have already been married for years.
Yeah.
How did it feel playing that out in front of the public like that?
Good question, you know, because we were married at the time, and this was for the fans, but with 20,000 plus fans in Madison Square Garden, and everybody's getting ready for the match, and I'm getting ready for a wedding, putting my tuxedo on, you know, it was kind of wild, you know what I mean? To talk about walking down the aisle into, I'd rather have gone into a cage match with Andre the Giant than.
The other half of that one is a couple of years later in WCW, you were paired with Elizabeth again. That was after the divorce.
That was after the divorce, right.
Was that hard on you to have to do that?
To me, it was like a full circle situation because, you know, if I hadn't have done that, then I hadn't have got over it. You know what I mean? Because, I don't believe in taking anything to the grave. You know what I mean? You know, because and me and Elizabeth are still friends. You know what I mean? Just something that didn't work, and it was a no problem situation. You know what I mean? And just, you know, life goes on, and, you shouldn't spend the rest of your life dwelling over any one thing.
Yeah, and what was the feeling winning the world title? How important was it for you to win the world championship for the
first time?
It
was pretty important, you know, because it was a situation where, you know, WWF is just like the place to be, the place to be, still is the place to be. And I think that everybody should get that buzz feeling, you know, when they do win it, you know, even though we are the kings of entertainment, you know, it still does mean something, you know what I mean? And then just winning the belt is not enough. It's how you carry the belt, because you're representing not only the organization, but all the fans, and including yourself, you know? So basically winning the belt, that's really cool, but taking the pressure, you know what I mean? Because there is a little bit of pressure involved, and wearing it well, and being able to, it's almost like finishing your term as president of the United States and then handing it over. You know, you just don't hand over a torch that's not lit and too big to hold.
Do you think that, you know, the perception was that Hogan was really putting himself up next to you, tagged as the Mega Powers a lot? Do you think that took away from it a bit? Because the WWE sort of kept Hogan up there on the same kind of pedestal.
Yeah.
Do you think that took away from your world title reign at all?
Hogan will try to suck blood from anybody to get himself over. That's something that everybody just understood and still understands throughout that time, but that's all right. We just kind of all knew it, you know what I mean? Anytime anybody did something good, we kind of looked over and there his face was, so it didn't bother me. It was just cool.
What's your relationship with Hulk Hogan right now?
No relationship. Mm-hmm. No, I like girls. He's got something else on his mind.
But what's your relationship with Eric Bischoff and the people on top of WCW right now in terms of, like, whether you might be able to go back in the future?
Oh, I'm sure I could go back if I picked up the phone and asked to go back. But my situation with them, I guess, would be just making it work as far as days and money, I guess. You know what I mean? But to me, it's more than that. It's career, you know, because I've already, you know, reach a certain position in wrestling, you know, and
that's a superstar status.
Well, you know, hopefully that's what I feel like I've done.
Yeah.
And just, you know, putting some money on the table, it's more than that. You know, it's more than the days on the, you know, table. So it's got to be something interesting, you know, getting in the middle of what's happening is what I'm all about. Because I'm used to being, you know, on that hot spot where people are gunning for me, you know what I mean? Or trying to gun for somebody that's on top of the mountain so they can get off so I can get on top of the mountain. That's my deal, you know? And anything less than that is, you know, just I just can't even comprehend it.
Yeah. What are the chances of us seeing you back in the WWF at some point?
Oh, that'd be sweet, but it's got to be on the right terms for them and for myself. You know, just like in anytime you get an agreement between either two people or a company and a person or two companies, you know, it's got to be a sweet deal where both people leave the table thinking that they did okay and that they're 100% motivated to go at it, you know, either together or against each other or whatever, you know, but, you know, in the right situation, I'm sure that could work, you know what I mean? Vince McMahon is a creative genius, there's no doubt about it, you know, and anytime that anybody was knocking him before, he's proved them all wrong. I mean, the votes are a zillion to nothing right now, and anybody that says he's not, it's out of jealousy.
Yeah. Ever since you and Hogan went to WCW in 94, the WWF has sort of given this image of the new generation to sort of counteract that. Do you think that would make it more difficult for you to go back, regardless of, like, how good you look or how good you wrestle? Do you think the fact that you were a star in the 80s would be held against you?
Absolutely. You know, that's definitely something that would be held against you because, you know, it's a perception. And everybody knows that an athlete's got a shelf life. So instead of having the Macho Man Randy Savage in his rookie year coming up, you know what I mean, looking good as Macho Man Randy Savage right now coming back, it's definitely going to count against me, you know. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, I'm not worried about it, because if it does count against me so much that they don't want to participate in it, that's cool. Mm-hmm. So I'm easy.
You ever consider working with maybe in Japan or in ECW or somewhere else other than the big two in North America?
Not really, because of the fact that business-wise, it would have to be where I had to do it rather than wanted to do it. And my whole life is because I want to do something rather than having to do it. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, I've been a really good businessman as far as my personal finances have gone. And I'm saying that that would be without, you know, having a situation where I'm looking down at that. I just don't want to go there. You know what I mean? It would have to be the WWF or nothing at all.
So you're at a point in your career now where you can, like, really choose. If this is really great for me, if it's not, I don't
right.
like it.
You know, probably I've been there for a long length of time. You know what I mean? But now especially, I just don't want to do anything that's a step backwards. It's more of a career move than a money move.
Mm-hmm. What, if anything, do you feel that you've left to accomplish in your career? Or is it just all fun from here?
Nothing really, you know what I mean? Just having fun, you know. You never want to get to the situation where you're not able to perform as good as what you performed in the past. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And you should always be ready to give back to the sport, as far as, you know, it's almost like tagging out. Mm-hmm. You know, and in a tag team match, you know, you want something left for the match, you know what I mean, to give to the guy tagging in, you know, passing the baton. You don't pass them something that's too heavy to hold, and, you know what I mean, just, you know, it's going to slide out of their hand, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's just one of those situations right there. I've watched baseball players play too long. I watch football players play too long, you know, just hold on, and that's not a cool situation.
Do you think it's possible that you might come back and, like Mick Foley a couple of months ago, retired, putting Triple H over as the new WWF champion, you know, in the retirement match? Do you think it's possible you'd come back
sure.
for a strong run
sure.
and put someone over?
Oh, yeah. I don't have a problem with that at all. Mm-hmm. No, man. You know what I mean? Because my situation is that, you know, anything that's good for the sport is good for me.